You are watching DHTV, the broadcast programming service of California State University, Dominguez Hills.
Hi, my name is Sergio Soto, and this is Sociology 101, Introduction to Sociology, where we focus on the individual and their roles in society, so the individual and society. Today is our first session of a semester-long class many of you are taking, but for those of you who are joining us for the first time or are flipping through the channels, you know, this is a class, of course, but there's no reason you can't participate either. The number to call in is 800-339-1193. In a few seconds, we'll also include email, askdhtvlive@gmail.com, where you can send your questions, comments, and insights. Now, for those of you who are part of the Young Scholars Program and are taking this course for credit, please do participate. Some of you may receive extra credit for your questions, your comments, your insights, your observations, and you know, above everything, you know, if you engage in this course, you will get more out of it. And if you're just a casual viewer, you know, you don't really have you know, too many opportunities in the world to engage a community, although a virtual community spanning you know, not only the internet, but also the cable subscribers who receive this channel. You also have an opportunity to, you know, share your ideas, share your thoughts. Now, the nice thing about sociology is, to a certain extent, we are experts. Now, we won't go as far as saying, you know, that we're all experts at sociology, because, you know, then I'd be out of a job. We are experts in the sense that we do live in a society, we understand parts of the society. Some of the things that we will discuss may be obvious to a certain extent, but we cannot let ourselves fall into this trap of not questioning the obvious, because you know, some of the things that we take for granted may not be so clear. You know, one thing I like to reinforce in the classes that I teach is that something like common sense is social construction. It really doesn't exist. It's not natural, I should say. We'll discuss the social construction of reality a little later on. But you know, we all participate in society. Some of us experience society in different ways, and your experiences do have a place in this course. So please do feel free, if you feel that you can comment on some of the things that we're discussing, do share your insight, okay? Because although I'm assigning the grades in this course, I'm the one that's in front of this camera, I don't necessarily claim to be the expert on everything. Some of you may know more about the world than I could ever read about or ever understand. Like, for example, being a male, I do not experience the world as a female does, even though I do understand, what's been written. You know, we'll talk about feminist theory as we go on. You know, I'll never be able to bridge that gap of what, you know, a woman or, you know, someone who is different than me experiences the world. And we'll discuss that as we go, and why that's so. As far as this module today, we'll explore the field of sociology. We'll introduce some of the basic concepts, some of the classical theorists that do shape the arguments and our understanding of the world as far as sociology goes. We'll discuss some of the differences and similarities between sociology and the other behavioral sciences. We will Begin introducing some terms like institution, agency, social structure, and we'll discuss what that means as we go forward. Okay. Now, as far as the course, those of you who are taking the class should know to access Blackboard immediately. There you'll find your syllabus. Now, we won't spend any time today or at all during the course of this lecture to review the syllabus, right? Our time is precious here, and we'll spend it on a lecture. But do read carefully, read through it carefully. If you have any questions, please do email me. My email is ssoto@csudh.edu. Those questions could, you know, pertain to the class, about the syllabus, or if you're having trouble accessing any of the content, do feel free to reach out to me. As far as the general public, I welcome your questions, but they're my lowest priority. So if I don't get to you or get to you right away, please do understand. But I do welcome questions from the general public. And, you know, I don't mind recommending, you know, different informational tools and resources as far as that goes. Going back to our Blackboard class, everything will be submitted through there. Your assignment, your exams will be on Blackboard. We have an excellent team here assisting us. The contact information is available on Blackboard, but please do, try out the class online. Check out the different modules, get the slides. I do include slides online so you can, use those to review some of the subject. There's also an expansive course materials catalog that's available there where you'll find detailed chapter outlines, some other lecture notes, and some exercises. Now, the exercises inside the course materials section are not awarded credit. You know, there's some sample quizzes, some exercises that you may choose to do, but to a certain extent, they're there for your own benefit. So, the class is really versatile in the sense that if you want more out of it, that's available. If you want to, get what's necessary for your grade, you know, we'll make sure that you have a thorough understanding once you get through. But, you know, do explore that. A lot of good stuff, a lot of interesting stuff, and a whole heap of things that can only help you. Okay. So having said that, we'll begin our discussion. What is sociology? Now, sociology, the simple kind of answer to this question is it's the study of society and individuals within them. The relationships between one's own agency and the institutions that surround us. Now, when we discuss agency, and we'll cover this again, it's our ability to do things. Some might even categorize it as free will. Okay? Now, imagine this, you can do almost anything, but what prevents you from doing some things? Like, right now, I might have an itch inside my nose. I might try to pick it, right? It looks like I learned this in magic school, right? It looks like you're picking it, picking your nose. But what keeps me from really picking my nose, right? You know, it might be a terrible itch, but what's keeping me from exercising that agency where I go and start digging for, mucus, I guess? Social norms. Right? Rules, unsaid rules. And think about how you learn about these rules. You might learn them from your parents, from teachers, and so on, right? Even television, okay? Television reproduces some of these values, some of these norms. They transmit these values. Once you get into culture, we'll explain that this is part of culture. These abstract ideas, they don't really exist. You can't touch them, but if you get them wrong, if you make a mistake, or if you're caught, in this instance, picking your nose, you might feel embarrassment, you might be shamed, and there are consequences that are very real. We might have an emotional reaction, or much worse. We'll deal with some, more serious matters as we go through. But that's what we're trying to understand in sociology. That's one part, you know, the values and norms and the beliefs that are inside the social structure. And the other part is these influences on our own behavior, on our own life chances. Life chances is a term to describe our ability to achieve or obtain the good things in life. Okay. They influence our agency, right? So, for instance, you know, what we're going to discuss next, we'll actually show you a video, and this will, you know, open up our televised discussion. Feel free to call in, write in. We'll start talking about minimum wage, right? Right now, that's been in the news. It's a very contentious issue. This discussion that we're having at an institutional level of whether the minimum wage should be raised or not, and we'll watch a short news clip describing what's going on in a few seconds. But before we get to that, we're also, you know, inside sociology, we also explore some of these, I suppose, for lack of a better term right now, to simplify these ideas or these influences that shape our lives. Like, for instance, we'll discuss the sociological imagination, but the sociological imagination is a tool that is given to us by C. Wright Mills, and we'll apply this after we watch the video with a little bit more context. But there are things that influence our lives that we seemingly don't have too much control over. Like, for instance, many of you are young, many of you are obtaining your first occupations, and many of you will be subjected to this minimum wage. Now, you know, we won't have time to really dissect it, but the fact that, you know, there's a minimum wage arguably protects you from, you know, being paid a lower wage, but at the same time, it also serves to, you know, influence your lives by limiting, you know, how much remuneration you can demand, right? And this income influences your life, the food you eat, the resources you have access to. Okay, when we talk about an economy, the term economy is used to describe how we distribute goods in our society. And many people most of you should already know how we distribute goods in our society, right? You have money, and you pay for things, right? And the value or price of things is dependent on, to a certain extent, the laws of supply and demand, right? Now, we'll start to kind of peel back, the patina that's disguising some of these things. We'll pull back the curtain so we can really look at these issues and how it influences human behavior a little deeper as we go through the course. But let's first watch this video, and then we'll discuss it. Do call in. And we'll flash the number when we come back. So let's watch Minimum Wage, Job Killer, or Poverty Fix.
Well, the federal minimum wage right now is $7.25 an hour. That's $15,000 a year for a full-time worker. It's way too low to support a person, let alone a family. And it hasn't gone up in 5 years. So every year that goes by without a raise, workers are effectively seeing a pay cut because their costs of living are going up and the minimum wage isn't.
In a nation as rich as ours, no one who works full-time and heads a household should live in poverty. But raising the minimum wage is not the best answer. The benefits of raising the minimum wage will mostly accrue to households that do not live in poverty. The reason for that is simple. Many low-wage workers do not live in low-income households. The teenage son of a millionaire qualifies for the minimum wage.
The minimum wage is not about kids and summer jobs. 88% of workers who would benefit if we raised the federal minimum wage to $10.10 an hour are adults. Their average age is 35, and many of them are supporting families. It's also important to note that our economy has really changed. You know, we lost a lot of decent paying jobs during the recession, and the jobs that are coming back now and the ones that are disproportionately fueling job growth are those in sectors like retail and fast food and home health care, where median pay is less than $10 an hour. So these are the jobs that more and more adults are taking and are going to be relying on to support themselves and their families.
Proponents of increasing the minimum wage are implicitly arguing that the burden of helping the working poor to rise should fall on the customers and employers of minimum wage workers. We should reject this argument. Instead, we should embrace the conviction that all of society is responsible for helping the working poor. Fast food restaurants and retail stores should help out, sure, but so should hedge fund managers, Wall Street executives, and the top 1%. An earnings subsidy like the EITC is a way to make sure that all of society is helping the working poor and not just their employers and customers.
Movement on raising the minimum wage was stalled in Congress in April by a Republican-led filibuster, but the issue isn't going away. Democrats say they plan to bring the minimum wage increase back up for a vote and look for it to be a major issue in this year's midterm campaign. What do you think? Should the federal minimum wage be raised? Let us know by posting or tweeting using the hashtag MakeTheCase.
Okay, welcome back. Just like our NBC News story there that we borrowed, what do you all think? Should we raise the minimum wage? Do call 800-339-1193. Make sure you give your name to our operators here. You know, they'll, you know, send you some extra credit on and down the line. If you're a little shy, do write in. A question is a question, whether it's spoken or written out. But let's introduce this idea of the sociological imagination. We'll use this issue to help break it down. Now, C. Wright Mills, a well-known sociologist, American sociologist, extremely important in shaping how we think about sociology today. He proposed this idea that we should have a sociological imagination, that we should use it as a tool to connect our personal troubles, right? What happens to you, at a personal level, to public issues, okay? Now, his argument was that we often don't see these personal troubles as part of the larger scheme of things. We don't see them connected to larger issues, public issues, issues that affect more than just one person. We tend to, think about them as just things that we have to deal with. However, some of these things we might not have control over. Some of these things we might feel powerless about, but through the promise of collective action, we perhaps could achieve some of these better things in life. We can maybe find more equality or fairness in the world should we act not only at the individual level, but collectively. And minimum wage, at least the discussion about increasing the minimum wage, is just an issue just like that, right? So say you're a fast food worker or a warehouse worker, you're pulling in the minimum wage. Here in California, it's a little higher. It's $8.75 now or $8.25. It's been increasing. There's discussion inside LA County to increase it. In San Francisco, I know it's one of the highest. I think it's over 10, but anyhow, say you're making minimum wage, right? How does that influence your life? Well, you're limited to where you can live. Perhaps you have to take in roommates. If you have children, perhaps they have to go without, or maybe you're not living in the best neighborhood you like to live in. Maybe you don't have transportation like a personal vehicle. You have to rely on public transportation. So it's shaping your life. But there you are. You may feel you can't do anything about it. Heck, it's just a system, so we have to put up with it. However, one thing that people are doing are getting some traction as far as trying to change things are protesting collectively, right? Using the political system to attempt to bring about change and increase the minimum wage, right? One person, is limited for what they can do, but collectively people can do things. And when we look at sociology, we're looking at collective action, we're looking at patterns, right? We're not only going, in this course, we're not only going to look at how these institutional things like rules, things like inside the economy influence our lives, we're also going to think about, how change happens, how we can create change. But this is just one side of the you know, discussion. Now, we do have a call, and we'll take the call now, and then we'll go through some of our emailed questions. So go ahead and, you know, Ian from Corona, how are you today?
Hi. On the question for
sorry to interrupt you. Can you turn on your TV a little bit? You know, the miracle of television is allowing me to travel through time and speak out through your television there.
Okay.
Go ahead, Ian.
Okay. Sorry.
It's all good.
So, on the question for the minimum wage, it sounds more of like it's an age difference for like if he's like older or if someone's younger. Like for the older people, it's the minimum wage should be raised, but then for the younger people, it should still be like how they have it originally.
Mm-hmm.
If it's more of an age difference.
Okay, so let me see if I get getting you right. You feel it's somewhat of a age discrimination issue, like just because
it seems
someone...
more of that sort of problem.
Okay,
like,
good.
If someone's supporting a family, the minimum wage should be raised more for them.
Okay, good. You know, one thing that we are seeing inside of our economy that is that some of these jobs that we once felt should be reserved for the young or the part of the population that's just starting their lives are more and more being populated by older adults, many adults with families. So a great issue, a great question, great comment. Thank you for calling in. And we'll go on to another question. But yes, age does matter. Sometimes it's easier for people to brush it off because some people might feel, well, these are just young people, right? You know, when I was young, you know, I just had to work hard too, and, you know, minimum wage was much less, right? But, you know, often we don't account for inflation. We also have a question that was sent in by Burgundy. I do not think that minimum wage should be raised. Higher wages for small-time jobs would result in less jobs, thus making the job force smaller and increasing unemployment. And that's one side of the argument. Absolutely. You know, if I owned a small business or even a large business, the cost of doing business would go up. This is something I might not welcome. Or some people, maybe not as empathetic, would say, well, some of these folks should use this as a driving force to have them work harder to earn an education and things like that. So there is no easy answer. Now, you know, I'll reserve my own opinions for some other time, but here we are discussing, we are exercising this sociological imagination. We're taking an issue that, you know, affects that to a certain extent dictates one, you know, an individual's life, and we're connecting it to the larger social structure, right? And something like a big policy change will have an impact on individuals in our society. Now, as we move forward, we'll have our discussion on poverty and inequality, and we'll bring back this issue, and then we'll kind of flesh it out a little bit more, and, you know, we'll consider the arguments a little deeper, okay? But the sociological imagination, you're forced to, and we'll continue to use it as we go through the class. We'll have a few more examples as we move forward. Before we went to our video, we started to discuss this concept of agency and social structure. Now, agency is a fancy word for your ability to do things, okay? Now, for instance, one could say that you could get any job in a society as long as you work for it, as long as you have the right credentials, or if you don't like your minimum wage job, you can get another job, right? But at the same time, our agency is limited, right? By personal factors, right? Like maybe you can't, you don't have access to other jobs. Like say the only jobs that are reasonably close to you are these minimum wage jobs, or maybe you don't have the sufficient education to demand or use as leverage towards higher pay, okay? This is where we start thinking about this social structure, right? The social structure is not only made up by individual units like ourselves, but also large institutions that are a collection of units, right? And we'll introduce this idea of institutions, and we'll discuss institutions as we go forward. Now, the first thing I'd like to say about institutions is that, we have to start thinking about them in a much broader sense. Usually when we refer to an institution, an individual might refer to it as just one single place. Like, for instance, Cal State Dominguez Hills is an institution. But when we talk about institutions inside society, they are the collection of the different, individuals, organizations inside that society that make up that institution. Like, for instance, this university is part of the institution of education, along with the other units like kindergarten through 12th grade schools, different colleges, different universities. This makes up the institution of education. And this institution of education, when we talk about, and shortly we'll talk about structural functionalism, has a purpose, right? The institution of education is charged with educating individuals so they can take their place inside another institution, which is the economy, right? When we think about the economy, it's this large, broad, overarching thing, but it's made up of jobs held by individuals, businesses, large and small, corporations, lending institutions, banks, all these different agents, all these different units. And collectively, these two institutions are interdependent, right? And we can bring in another institution like the family, okay? The family is the most basic institution in our society. It's where people are created. It's where we first are socialized. And we'll introduce this term a little later on, but let me define it right now. The more often you hear it, the better. Socialization is learning about society through interaction, through the everyday, right? You first learn how to behave, who you are as far as identity inside the family, right? And then you go off to the institution of education, which your kindergarten class all the way to 12th grade, maybe you get a degree, and then you finally join the economy after you reach appropriate age, you join the economy, right? Or maybe you depend on the economy to raise your family, right? Everything's interdependent. Everything influences itself. These institutions in society are not isolated from each other. Just keep that in mind. And with this all, it creates a social structure, right? Along with these institutions, there's also, shared values, so shared beliefs, shared norms, right, that do influence our lives, okay? Now, one of the things about these norms or understanding the world is, we in sociology, we argue that they're socially constructed, okay? Next we'll discuss the social construction of reality. Now, let me give you an example first, okay? Some of us are born in cities. We might live in a city all our lives. Streets, cars, tall buildings made out of concrete, houses made out of wood and drywall seem natural. But there's nothing natural about a city, right? It's constructed by people over time, okay? Our values, our beliefs, our norms are no different. They're patterned behavior, except that over time, we don't really see where they emerge. They're replicated over time, ritualized, then institutionalized, that they seem natural. So things like, when people refer to common sense, we're not saying that it doesn't have an influence on your lives. We're not saying that it doesn't exist. But what we are saying is that it is a social construction that perhaps you can question its, how real it really is, or whether it's, really such, you know, if such a thing like common sense, something that we all share, really, you know, really exists in the sense that it's innate, you know, or transcribed onto our DNA. Okay, the social construction of reality, you know, is based on how we understand information. We learn about reality through this process of socialization. Like, for instance, here I have a pen. Now, if you had never seen a pen before, right, it would be strange, it would be different, okay? But somewhere along the line, you were told that this is the name of this object, this is how we use it, this is how you hold it, there's an appropriate way to hold it, and there are appropriate things to do with it, okay? We can think about our systems of language, okay? You know, you might think about a time when you heard some kind of language you didn't know. It just sounds like a bunch of sounds and following a pattern cadence, right? You know, something like speech is something we're taught, and speech is just a collection of symbols. You learn A, B, C, you learn the sounds they make, A, B, K, right? You can put these collections of sounds together, C, A, T, a cat. Now you have an image of a cat in your head. It might not be the same as the image other people have, but, you know, forgetting that for a second, just think about how you're taught how to understand not only language, but reality, how the world works. Okay, eventually when we get to culture, we'll talk about ethnocentrism and the cultural relativity. But, you know, to a certain extent, people have a bias to their own reality because it's what they know. It's what's been successful for them. It's how they understand the world. And when we talk again about the social construction of reality, it's how you understand the world, right? There's rhyme and reason to it. But again, you know, there's nothing natural about it, okay? As we move forward, we'll also talk about social order and social change. These rules, these norms in society make civilization, make society possible, right? When we think about society, right, you know, there's rules everywhere. You know, imagine the first day of class, okay? You don't know the instructor, you don't know the rules in the class yet, but you use patterned behavior to claim a seat, right? Maybe you walk in and you choose a seat that you like. You know, it's open, it's empty, right? You might sit towards the front because you believe that if you sit towards the front, you'll have a better experience. You'll be able to interact with the instructor. Or you might sit in the back because you might, you know, want to take a nap, right? But say you get in a little later and there's a few seats, right? Are you allowed to ask someone to get up and move chairs? Probably not, right? Because our pattern behavior, what we learned before, says that the rules of selecting a seat are first come, first serve, right? But even that, you know, you're using what you know, pattern behavior, right? You're, you know, we all do this. That's why, you know, sociology speaks directly to us. We use it every day. We participate in society. Another example I can give you is, say you... you go to a fancy restaurant, okay? You know, there's a plethora of forks sitting in front of you, all the different, sizes and slightly different shapes. How do you select the fork that you want to use or that you're supposed to use? Because, again, you know or you've been told that there are forks that you use for certain dishes and there are forks that you use that you would never use, right? These are norms. These are rules. You don't want the embarrassment of selecting the wrong fork, or outing yourself as an individual that doesn't belong in this social setting. So what do? Well, the safe thing to do is to watch other people, to look for patterns, see what the person in front of you, maybe a family member, maybe a friend, see what fork they use, right? And then you copy them. Right? You might want to think about and even share an experience, right? This is a perfect time to call and share an experience, to write in and share an experience where maybe you had to take a step back and look for pattern behavior, right? Or some of these rules that we take for granted. Like, for example, queuing in line. When, there's an excellent work called McDonald's in Hong Kong that writes about how, the first McDonald's restaurant was introduced in Hong Kong and how cultural patterns didn't really, weren't as compatible with the restaurant experience, at least initially. Something like queuing in line, where you stand in line right behind another person to wait to put in your order, is something that the public had to be taught, right? Before it used to, it was a free-for-all. And this is in the 80s. People would rush up to the counter, demand service, much, those of you who are, of appropriate age might compare it to the experience of trying to order a drink at a very busy bar, right? Usually, people would get loud, people would flash money, people would push, right? This is not the experience that you have when you go to a, fast food restaurant today, right? The expectation is to line up in front of somebody, right? So this is something that had to be taught, but this is something, again, that we take for granted, right? It creates social order. It keeps people from fighting, okay? So these little rules, these little nuances are much deeper, much more important to our everyday life than we realize. And that's what we explore partially in sociology, right? We look at all of society, okay? Now, what I want to do next, okay, before we begin our discussion about, as we look further at individuals and institutions, we're gonna watch a short video. It's called Poverty's Effects Pop Up in Schools. Okay, it's a short video, about 2 minutes. But what I want you to look out for is, consider how something like an educational institution not only prepares you to participate in society, but is also a place or a space where inequalities exist. Okay. Even in this class that we are participating in, those of you who are doing it for a grade, I know that there's inequalities. I know some of you might not be able to afford a book right away. You might miss out the first assignment, the first test, right? Really problematic. Right there, you've been put at a disadvantage. Or some of you might find it difficult to do your coursework. Maybe you have trouble at home. You can't find a quiet place to study or work. Right? Or maybe you have, if you're employed, right? You get home tired, okay? Maybe the sound thing to do is to sleep instead of write that paper. Now, it's going to influence your life. And the easy thing to say is, well, to each his own, everybody, has different parameters that they have to navigate and deal with. But in sociology, we look at these things and see how they can be systems of oppression and privilege. Okay, because at the same time where someone, because of their lack of resources, might experience a disadvantage, others will experience an advantage. Like say you get the nice edition, that has full color pictures, and this is not the one we assign. I assign the three color one, black, white from the pages, and a blue, right? I'm a cheapskate, but, say you're able to, afford the nicer edition, but a clearer example would be like, say you have reliable, fast internet at home, okay? Where someone might be at a disadvantage because they can only do their online coursework from school, from a library, or even, some kind of commercial establishment like a Starbucks or a McDonald's. These aren't endorsements. They're just common places that I know you all will understand, right? That's a disadvantage, right? You have to work around your schedule. You have to, you might not have as much time to work on your paper. You might not be able to research that long. Where on the other side, you might have these advantages, that, like a fast internet connection that's stable and at home in your room, right? These will create systems of inequality just there, something as simple as that, right? And the world is filled with that. The misconception, or even we can go as far as saying a lie in society, right? A myth is that the world is truly created equal. Like everyone in our world is not created equally, I'm sorry, but has the same advantages, that the playing field is level. This is the myth, that the playing field is level. And this is going back to the sociological imagination. The truth is the playing level is not level. Some of us, if we conceptualize society as a race, some of us are 10 miles away from the starting line. Does that mean you can't win the race or finish with a good time? You absolutely can, but the probability of that happening is much more in the realm of unlikely, right? And then for some of us, right, we can start maybe a mile away from the finish line, okay? Because when we think about the sociological imagination, it's not only about our individual experience or individual qualities, it's also about history, right? For instance, your parents' history shapes your history, okay? If your parents are extremely affluent, of course they're going to want to give you the advantages that they can afford. If you're having trouble in math, you might use this as a thought experiment. Like if you have children, right? Maybe you're all going to go to great colleges, great universities. If you have children, okay, and they have trouble with, in high school with something like geometry, will you be able to help them? Okay, some of you will have the cultural, the human capital to help them. You might be able to sit down and understand what's going on here. Others might not, but at that point, what do you do? Well, you might get a tutor, right? That takes money, right? Right there, you know, you're creating, you know, you are, you know, a little bit more oppressed than your, another person inside class. So, you know, these are things to think about. History is very important. And we'll discuss this as we move forward, right? Again, the sociological imagination is, making these connections to our personal experience, making connections from our personal experience to these institutional historical forces that exist. You know, just to throw one more out there, we'll eventually talk about race and gender. Even before you're born, you know, these stigmas, these stereotypes exist. And when you're born, you have to navigate them, right? You're put at a disadvantage because of these things. But anyway, let's watch our video, Poverty's Effects pop up in schools. We'll discuss it a little, and then we'll come back and we'll start our discussion on key theorists that lay the foundation for sociology and what we're going to explore in this course. And then so let's watch this video and we'll be right back.
One of every five Michigan children is living in poverty. That according to a report out today. The rate is rising around the state, and it's rising faster than the state average in Kent, Muskegon, and Ottawa counties. 24-Hour News 8's Tony Tagliavia spent some time in a suburban school district today and has more on how the issue is popping up there. Tony?
Brian and Sue, the principal of an eastern Ottawa County elementary school, says the issue is even coming up with kids' homework.
Families that don't have as much time to help their kids with their homework at night because they're worried about making their bills or they're working a second job in the evening. So we see a decrease in kids getting their homework done, so we have to provide more supports for them to do that.
And Renee Garcia, principal at Jennison's Bursley Elementary, says roughly 40% of her students meet poverty standards for a free or reduced lunch. She says more students aren't able to pay for field trips. She says families stressing about paying for the basics are leading to behavioral problems at school. And Garcia says more children are coming to school sick.
And I think that's because our parents need to work. They need to be at their job, they need to earn that paycheck, and they need a safe place for their kids.
Today's numbers from the Kids Count report show what's happening at Bursley Elementary is hardly unique in Ottawa County. Child poverty is defined as earning $21,800 or less for a family of four. And the rate of child poverty in Ottawa County has grown 20% between 2005 and 2008.
It doesn't surprise me because it's something that we have been dealing with day in and day out for, you know, the last 8 years.
It's grown 12% in both Kent and Muskegon counties. All three of those rates are faster than the state average. Kalamazoo County's child poverty rate grew by 2%. That's slower than the state average. This latest poverty data comes from 2008. With the job losses we've seen since then, it's certainly possible, if not probable, that rates have gotten worse. Back in Jenison, the principal says despite some students facing challenges, they're still excelling on state standardized tests. This report also shows abuse and neglect cases are on the rise, but infant mortality rates are largely declining, especially in Muskegon County. Sue?
Tony, thank you.
Welcome back. Now, that was in Michigan, but you'll find similar stories here in Los Angeles County, across the United States, across the world. But again, you know, do feel free to call us in, call in 800-339-1193. Insights are welcome, questions are welcome, comments are welcome. You know, if you feel up to it, share a personal experience. You know, we are here to not only understand and learn about sociology, but deconstruct our own personal lives so we can better understand the opportunities and obstacles that we'll, you know, that we'll use to navigate our life from here on out. You know, that's the empowering thing about sociology. Yeah, you begin not only exercise critical thought, but you also begin to better understand this process of better understanding the society that's in front of you and how you can better navigate it. But here we have a situation where children are being children are affected by poverty, right? Their household income might not be that much. They might miss meals. And it certainly has an effect on education. Now, you might ask yourself, well, why is this a problem? Well, for those of us who see it as a problem in society, know that, you know, one of the surest ways to make your way out of poverty is to get a good education, right? To be trained formally to enter the economy and claim one of these jobs that offer higher remuneration. You know, you might ask yourself why you're in this class, those of you who are taking it for credit. Well, you know, some of you might say, you know, it's, you know, you want to find out what sociology is, you love sociology, you know, but most of you are probably here for the grade, right? But why is that? You know, eventually you know that you'll go off to the university, you'll go off to college, and you'll need this, you know, on your transcript so you can get your diploma, and then you can enter a part of the workforce that basically that credential, that credential serves as a barrier. So some people are kept out, and you're, you know, once you achieve that, you're, you know, whatever specialty you get, whatever major, whatever degree you get it in, you're able to demand a higher pay, right? You know, we'll talk about social mobility, but inside our system, you know, social mobility is possible, upward and downward, right? That's one of the great things about our society. But at the same time, not everyone is dealt the same hand. Some folks have to work harder than others, but that's not to say it's still not possible, okay? So what we're going to do next, we're going to kind of shift gears a little. That's been your sort of overview for the class. It's going to give you some direction. Here we'll explore some of the more abstract things about sociology. Norms, values, beliefs, as we begin to introduce our key theorists. Okay. Now, the theorists that we're going to name here are kind of like the big figures inside sociology. They are, if it was music, these are the folks that everybody knows, like the Beatles, maybe, a little bit more classical, I guess, but, you know, further back. But these are the big names, right? The work we're going to do will bring in some more contemporaries, but think about these figures as the foundation or the theorists that sort of shape and change the direction of how we think about our social world. Also keep in mind that their work was built atop centuries of philosophical thought. They built upon a foundation of education, research and theory that came before them. But this is what gives us sociology these key figures. And the first one we'll discuss is Auguste Comte, right? To keep it kind of short, we're kind of racing the clock here a little bit. Auguste Comte is described as the father of sociology. He coined the term. He connected this concept of using empirical evidence, of using science to understand society, with the hopes of helping humanity, right? To kind of think about where Auguste Comte was coming from, you know, keep in mind that when he was writing, you had revolution, you had industrialization, and the big thing about industrialization, it's called the Industrial Revolution, but the reason it's a revolution is it dramatically upended, it changed completely the way people lived, right? To give you an example, when we get into the family, we'll talk about the family-based economy compared to the wage-based economy, right? People went from a system that for the most part, produced the majority of the things they needed. For example, if you wanted dinner, you grew it, you hunted it, you farmed it. Okay, if you needed butter or a candle, you made it. If you needed new clothes, you made it, or you bartered it with something that you grew. Money existed, but it wasn't used in the same fashion that we use it today. That came about with, the Industrial Revolution. And one thing to keep in mind, people around the world experienced the Industrial Revolution at different times. But, just to kind of keep these ideas kind of centered, what this did to the family is that it shifted it from, again, a family-based economy where everything was produced in the home, to one where people worked for a wage. They traded their labor for a wage. Before, labor was used to produce what they needed, the family needed. Now it was, basically sold for a wage. And since you're selling your wage, you use that wage to buy the commodities that you need. Okay, without going into it, thoroughly, this changed the structure of the family. This is where you begin to see the rise of the nuclear family. We see the rise of individualism. It had an influence on our concept of love, right? This revolutionary concept of, marrying for emotional sentiment or love rather than securing wealth or prestige or something to that effect, okay? Even something, we can talk about love, we take it for granted, it's a norm, it's a value. It didn't just, it's not ingrained in our DNA. It came about, roughly 100, 150 years ago, okay? But we'll discuss this, as we go forward, maybe 200 years ago. Okay, don't quote me on numbers just yet. I don't have the right notes in front of me. But anyhow, Auguste Comte. So he was worried about the world. He sees all this, disorder. He sees revolution. He sees all these things being displaced. And, he sees sociology as a promise, as a way of, helping society with the power of science, right? Just another note, one of the things that, you have to keep in mind as we go through this course or any course is that, science changed the way, people explain the world. Like before, mysticism and religion was the way we explain the world. Like for instance, you're watching this on a monitor, on a television, through YouTube. If you don't, most of us don't know how this technology really works, right? But the assumption isn't that there are fairies, that this is the work of some wizard, or that angels are performing a miracle. We make the assumption that there's science behind that, right? That there's electricity, electrons that are being manipulated through, you know, devices constructed by people, okay? So, you know, a little bit of that, you know, that's kind of the, you know, why, you know, science is sort of this juggernaut. For the most part, as we go through this class, this is really the only time we'll discuss Auguste Comte, his contribution as the founder of sociology and the one who coined the term. Someone who we will concentrate on is Emile Durkheim, okay? Now, Emile Durkheim, others would argue that he's the real father of sociology. He's the fella who put sociology on the map. You know, prior to that, you know, most people didn't, you know, call themselves sociologists. He's the first person to really, you know, pour a, you know, solid foundation, right? And, you know, promote this this science, right? A little later, we'll talk about Karl Marx. If you would have asked Karl Marx whether he's a sociologist or not, he'd say no, right? He's a philosopher and an economist. But Emile Durkheim. So let's talk about Emile Durkheim's contributions, right? You know, Emile Durkheim will fall into this category of functionalist or structural functionalist that we'll use in this course. For the most part, we'll concentrate on three major theoretical paradigms. Keep in mind that when we talk about these paradigms, everything gets lumped in with other, you know, inside these schools of thought. For him, it's structural functionalism, okay? But keep in mind, these are a collection of different theories. They share the same foundation, but they in themselves may argue different points or understand the world slightly differently. The other two is symbolic interactionism and conflict theory. And inside conflict theory, you'll find Karl Marx, and he's the next person we'll talk about. But first, Emile Durkheim. Emile Durkheim, really gave functionalism a backbone. And we'll explain structural functionalism a little bit, okay? Structural functionalism views society as a harmonious kind of arrangement of institutions. The term he would describe our society as is as an organic one. He wrote about both mechanical solidarity and organic solidarity. If we look at our society, you know, it would fall under what he would argue would be an organic society. We have organic solidarity, where the division of labor is so specialized, right? Everyone doesn't do the same thing, right? We all do different things. Even this class is all about specific science. We all do different things, and we're all interdependent with each other, okay? Like, for instance, I teach this class. The connection between me and you is very direct. I need you here taking this course in order for, you know, for me to have this occupation, okay? But the connections to other people in our society aren't that clear. Like, there's a trucker right now, maybe on the 710 freeway here in the Los Angeles area, bringing me, he doesn't know he's bringing me yet, right? My favorite cereal that I need to start every morning, okay? It's going to a warehouse, right? Those warehouse workers who are going to unload that truck, divide up the contents of that truck to send it to different stores on smaller trucks, will have an influence on my life. And then those, you know, truckers will take it to a store, someone will put it on the shelf, I'll go in, I'll put it in my cart, I'll pay for it, I'll walk out. But, you know, all that labor's, to borrow a term from Marx, is invisible. But we are all interdependent, okay? The institutions in our society are interdependent, okay? When we talk about organic solidarity, we're referring to an organism, okay? an organism like our own, bodies. Okay, every institution can be thought of as an organ. For instance, the economy might be the lungs. The institution of education might be your stomach, and without one, we would die or have a terrible time if it was injured, okay? And the stomach needs the lungs for oxygen, and the lungs need the stomach for nutrients. So right there, you have interdependent society, okay? The other part, and we'll juxtapose this with Marx, is that he presents this idea of a collective conscious, okay? One of Durkheim's important contributions is his coining and defending of a phenomenon called anomie. Okay, this is a state of normlessness. You know, for a simple answer. Okay, this is connected to the collective conscious. Like collectively, we have sort of a moral compass. We may not agree with everything that the moral compass says, but collectively we have these rules, these values, these beliefs that we all use to make sense of our lives. Now, for Durkheim, as societies become more organic, the social constraint or the power of these norms, you know, aren't as rigid. We can deviate from them. And what really put Durkheim on the map was his study of suicide. What he did is he looked at different societies over a period of time, okay? And he came with some conclusions. You know, some of the social like disorder that came with urban life increased one's likelihood of suicide or the rates of suicide within countries. The other side of it was that he also connected it to religion. Like, for instance, societies where societies that were predominantly Catholic, he saw a lower rate of suicide, right? And his argument was that according to Catholicism, what happens to an individual if they should take their life is very clear. You know, they're basically punished with being condemned to hell, right? Which is something people don't want, right? So if their life is, terrible, right? The penalty is much worse. With other religions, like for instance, like with Protestantism, you know, it may not be as clear, right? So that was just one of those things. But again, you know, inside society, we can think about our own society. The values and norms that dictate our lives aren't as rigid. When I say rigid, they're not as strict, right? We have some elasticity, and that allows for people to experience anomie. And even a personal, you know, the last part of this is even a personal act, a very intimate act, something like suicide is, you know, and this is his argument, this is why he puts sociology on the map. Even a personal act like suicide is connected to the social structure, right? It's connected to societal phenomenon, okay? Even recently with the economic collapse in 2008, the suicide rates jumped for middle-class white men. And the reason for that is that many of these men were middle managers, they lost their jobs, and they've had trouble adapting to the new reality that we call, this economy, okay? Some people weren't able to transition, right? Now, not every, anomic experience results in suicide, but this experience of anomie, increases the probability, right? We'll clarify this as we go, but to be anomic doesn't necessarily mean that, you know, it's strictly in the realm of discussing suicide. It's about the constraint or the power to constrain that the values and belief systems in our culture have over individuals. Like, for instance, you know, you might experience anomie and you're more likely to steal. You're more likely to be deviant, right? If you like Breaking Bad, you know, you can make an argument that, you know, when faced with cancer and the pressure of not only providing for his family, but, paying for his own chemotherapy, Walter White, who's the protagonist in that show, experienced a gnomic state and created a new means and goal, a new set of goal means. Well, he adopted innovative means to achieve his goal, which is to survive and provide for his family. Something that, you know, a goal that we can all share, you know, if we are, you know, if we have family, right? We won't go too deep into that, you know, there'll be a time and place for that. Next, I do want to discuss, begin our discussion on Marx, okay? So what I'd like to do first before we go into Marx is watch a short clip of a animated film called Por Us. It's about 4 minutes and 24 seconds long. I do encourage you all to watch this. There's a great website with other documentaries that's been established by ITV and PBS here in our country called Why Poverty. So if you find this interesting or would like to watch the full film, it is available for free via YouTube or these other channels. And this is a PBS product, so we will only watch about 4 minutes, but we'll discuss this. There's a little part where we're gonna watch where we are introduced to Karl Marx, some of his ideology, and some historical events that will help us understand his role in not only sociology, but the shape of not only politics and economics here, you know, today in the year, 2014. So let's go ahead and watch that, and then we'll be right back.
It was almost a pornography of poverty. In response, there is a public outcry, and the government is forced to, in turn, respond to poverty.
The rich often seem to want to help the poor, but it never seems to change the system. Ahead of you, you see Karl Marx, the founder of communism. You ask him, why are the rich getting richer, but not me?
The rich will do anything for the poor except stop exploiting them.
Karl is nice and makes you a cup of tea. You tell him, I want to rise out of poverty, but how can I do this?
Let the ruling classes tremble at a communist revolution.
Karl Marx basically believed that poverty was the result of the capitalist system being one in which companies are organized for profit and their main motive is to make more profit. And he believed that you could maximize profit by keeping wages as low as possible.
You look around for the revolutionary industrial proletariat that Uncle Karl told you about, but you find yourself swept along in a different kind of crowd. Thousands of peasants and freed slaves are going up into the mountains of Brazil. Now you are a follower of a renegade preacher, Antonio Conselheiro, whose teachings combine Christianity, communism, free love, and of course, the end of the world.
The reign of God is nigh. He will descend in majesty, cast down the mighty and exalt the sufferers, the poor, his poor.
Antonio Conselheiro preached the end of days thus turning the language of religion into a political weapon with economic consequences.
2 years later, and you have a new home in a new city of the poor. 30,000 people live here.
The Brazilian Republic reacts in order to suppress what was effectively movement of the wretched of the earth reclaiming their own futures.
Quick, man the barricades of the city. Your rifle is old and rusty, and you are under attack from the Brazilian army. There are 10,000 troops with machine guns, and yet their bullets can't kill you. You find the real revolutionary proletariat. You strike, you protest, you fight.
So comrades, come on and rally.
Across the world, you overthrow governments, though sometimes you have to settle for equal rights and higher wages.
The elite doesn't just give way. Mass improvements, I think, come from people organizing themselves. The poor get the poor out of poverty.
You are on your way up in the West. The government builds sewers and installs water pipes. Sanitation is better than revolution.
What did begin to change in the industrializing countries in the middle of the 19th century was a rise of real incomes, even in the working class.
Welcome back. Okay, so again, that was a short clip from Poor Us. And if you search it on your favorite search engine, you should be able to find it. It's about an hour in length. I do highly recommend it, but let's talk about what we just watched. Right there, we are introduced to Karl Marx. We'll go into Karl Marx in detail. Most folks know about him as far as his role in promoting communism. And, you know, to a certain extent, here in the West, in the United States especially, due to the politics of the Cold War. He is a specter. He is the boogeyman in the night. So one of the first things I'd like to say is that although we are going to, we are going to bring in Marx, we'll talk about Marxism, what that means and what that is. You know, the problem with Marx for people, for the most part, at least this is my perspective, is not his theory. Is not how he argues the world or how the world works, but his solution, which was a class revolution. Okay, here in sociology, you know, how he describes our relationship to labor and industry is, you know, what is of value, right? It's valuable because, he basically lays this foundation that argues that conflict is the order of society, that we are in competition with each other, and that a capitalist system, which is how our economy is organized, is inherently exploitive, right? Briefly, you know, we can describe this, right? Like, for instance, if you work for a wage, okay, you are, you know, the wage you earn is set per hour. Let's say you work at a very busy sandwich shop, okay? If you make 100 sandwiches and, you know, you're very good at your job, 100 sandwiches in an hour, maybe you're paid well, comparatively, maybe you make $10 an hour, right? You're just paid that $10, whether you work harder, faster, or, you know, regardless, you know, that profit isn't shared. And according to Marx, the only thing that can create this surplus value, this profit, is labor. right? One way we can think about it, and you know, we'll bring in private property, this concept of private property together here, is that in our society, we can own things. We can own something like a forest. And you might use, you know, this is a thought exercise, right? You own a forest, but how do you make a profit from a forest? Okay, you might choose to cut it down and create lumber. Now, in order to create that lumber, you need labor. And it's all well and good if it's your own labor, right? Because you enjoy the profit directly. You cut down the tree, you turn it into lumber, then you sell it. There's no exploitation here. But if you buy someone's wage, the object of this game, if you will, is not to share equally in the profit, but to keep the profit yourself, because that's what you're entitled to because you own this property. And can anyone else come in and cut down their tree and make this profit? No, because you own it, right? So to a certain extent, you know, Marx sees this as a system of exploitation because, you know, essentially those who have access to the resources, the, you know, whether it's a factory or in this case, a forest, not only control the mechanism to create wealth, which is, you know, turning that forest into lumber, right? And it's privately held, but also they control, you know, to a certain extent, that worker's wages. I mean, they get exploited, right? And when we talk about exploitation, you know, usually when we use it in our society, it's a, you know, very knee-jerk, reactionary term. But for Marx, this is what it boils down to. That's why he thinks it's immoral and it should change, right? Now, unfortunately, we don't have as much time, so we can't go into, you know, why he was wrong about class revolution or, you know, why, you know, his views were short-sighted. But do understand that as we go through this course, you know, Marx is, again, the foundation of some of the ideas we're going to explore. We'll also discuss Max Weber, who really fills out some of this argument. But for Marx, again, you know, society is fueled by exploitation. The other side, and this is the valuable part, is that he argues that societal change is rooted in class struggle, right? All of history hitherto has been a history of class struggle. If you think back to your history classes, you know, who replaced monarchies? Well, the mercantile class. That's one class overthrowing the other. And for Marx, some argue that the current system, you know, that we have was a transitory period, right? Towards, a society ruled by the proletariat or the worker, okay? But again, you know, he gives us our, you know, a lot of insight to understand how our economy works. You know, his what he claims isn't all that strange or different from what is talked about in or taught even today in economics. If you were to ask Karl Marx what his, profession is, he would be a philosopher in economics, an economist. Right? So really his work was describing how economics not only influences our agency, but our its relationship to the social structure, right? To power and who has power. And a lot of his basic arguments, like the way capital works, are no different, or some even argue that he plagiarized folks like Smith and Ricardo, okay? And, you know, but again, you know, the valuable thing about Marx is he's directly connecting how economic forces, cultural forces, influence our lives, okay? Now, he is going to be the basis for, you know, a lot of the theories that we're going to put forward, like conflict theory. So, you know, we will revisit some of his ideas as we move forward. But again, this is one of the major theories. Next is Max Weber. Okay, Max Weber, out of the few sociologists that we've covered so far, I think he's the most significant, the most important. He contributes to not only structural functionalism, conflict theory, and symbolic interactionism. He's the heavyweight here. He, for instance, where some people might accuse Marx of being economic determinist, and you know, hopefully I don't get any emails. I'm not claiming he's an economic determinist. I know some folks make this claim. But what Weber pulls in is that it's not only economics that influence our social position, but also prestige and, its property prestige and political power, okay? He understood that it's not only what we own, but how we're viewed and how connected we are to a system, right? That influences what we can get done or what kind of constraints we have in the world. He also gives us a view of how we are organized with his work on the bureaucracy, okay? And how values, morals, and beliefs can shape societies, right? If we had a little bit more time, we'd discuss the spirit of capitalism and the Protestant ethic. To put this in short, he argues that Protestantism was important to capitalism because many of the values and beliefs and morals that we associate with capitalism today actually emerge from the Protestants. In essence, Protestants became successful. Other people saw this. They patterned their behavior after, you know, not only what they were doing, but what they believed. And over time, something like, we can take a concept like, wasting time, okay? If you waste my time, if I waste your time, it's immoral, it's sinful. Think about where that came from, right? Having a hard working ethic, having an ethic that of working hard, okay? For Protestants, this was next to godliness, working hard. But again, where did that come about? Okay, our text goes through this in detail. Unfortunately, we're constrained by time, so we can't really go through the nuts and bolts of it. But Max Weber, we will revisit. We'll revisit his arguments about rationality, okay, which are very important, right? Because it's how we organize our world. For instance, this institution and most organizations are bureaucracies. Bureaucracies are guided by the principles of efficiency, right? Efficient with resources and efficient with time, okay? And these are hierarchies, right? We can even, think about this. Like if you're told to manage a group of 30 people, 50 people, how are you going to organize them, right? Chances are you're going to use some bureaucratic modes of management, okay? We assume that bureaucracies are in place in the world around us. Like, for example, if you don't like something at a department store or some business, you automatically might say something like, let me speak to your manager. What you're assuming right there is that some kind of hierarchy is in place, right? You know, and of course, there's no sign to say, okay, this is the chain of command, or most places aren't ran by collectives or things like that. But things to consider. Okay, we'll also explore. I do want to introduce W.E.B. Du Bois, very important American sociologist, one I admire tremendously. Wrote The Souls of Black Folks. Early on contributed to the discussion of race with his work, again, Souls of Black Folks, where he introduces the idea of the double consciousness. This is an argument that states that if you are the other, in this case, if you were African American or Black, you not only understand who you are, but how you're perceived by society. Now, this is a great contribution because, again, if we have privilege, if we know exactly if we don't experience oppression, we might not be aware that people are treated differently due to their gender or sex or color of their skin, okay? Now, W.E.B. Du Bois wrote, around 100 years ago, okay? He wrote about the racial wage where, just because someone was Black, they would be paid less for the same work a white counterpart might do, for the same kind of work done by a white counterpart, right? Something like this still exists today, right? Very important figure. I'll try to post a video that I intended to show you all today online so you can get a little better idea of what's going on here. We'll talk about symbolic interactionism. This is the use of symbols, right? And these are the, we're going to go over the theories that we're going to explore and that we're going to share. So one is symbolic interactionism. Here we find folks like like Mead, like Cooley, Goffman. And with symbolic interactionism, this is a micro theory, right? We look at the everyday interaction that provide us with meaning and understanding about the world around us, okay? We'll discuss about the construction of identity. How do we know who we are and how do we understand it? We'll explore, some more functionalism, okay? Here we'll not only revisit Durkheim, but we'll talk about Robert Merton, okay? And we'll talk about his views of how institutions work, right? With manifest function, latent function, U function, and dysfunction. To kind of break it down very quickly, every institution, like the institution of education, has a manifest function. This is an intended function. Like the intention of the institution of education is to educate, right? Latent function would be an unintended consequence, right? And when we use consequence, it's not necessarily negative. So a consequence is something like you might go to school to be educated, but you also make friends. You learn to socialize and you learn about the hidden curriculum. Like, for instance, you're taught to obey authority. And, something that you might connect to your own personal life might be, you might think back to elementary school. If you went to somewhere that was very rigid, they might have had you stand in line, right? And you can't go anywhere. You can't be excused unless your line is straight, quiet, and everyone's looking forward. But ask yourself, what's the function of that? Well, it's, one could argue that it's a form of creating, instilling certain beliefs about authority and social conformity inside individuals, okay? So we'll explore that as we go. And of course, dysfunction is when things don't work. For example, if the institution of education doesn't work and it might hurt the economy, this is a concern that people have right now. We'll explore Marxism and class conflict. We'll explore feminist theory as we move forward. And we'll also think about rational choice. This is the preferred kind of theory that economists use. This is where human behavior is viewed through a lens that individuals are attempting to maximize the rewards and minimize the penalties in their lives. Like, for instance, a quick example is one might argue not to tip, okay? An economist, like say you go to Kansas City, it's only time you're going to be in Kansas City. A rational theorist might say you shouldn't tip because the point of tipping is to ensure good service in the future. If you're never going to be there, you're at a loss if you tip. So you don't have to tip because you won't get any future service. And last, we'll explore postmodernity. This is where we, challenge the ideas of there being grand narratives. But that's it for today. Thank you for joining us. This will be posted on YouTube. And so long for today. Bye-bye.